Hello, welcome to TRUMPF. I'm Brett Thompson. This is my friend and colleague, Ian Frank. We're going to do a little bit of high power cutting for you today. So I'm going to run through a couple different thicker materials, do a little bit of nitrogen cutting, do a little bit of oxygen cutting. But before we actually get to the action, we're going to go through some of the unique points of the optical chain on the machine we have here, the TruLaser 5030 fiber with a TruDisc 24,001. All right, so let's head over. Okay, now, okay, Mike, am I sharing my screen right now? Excellent, thank you very much. Okay, so like I mentioned, I want to touch on a couple of the unique points about the optical chain on this machine. And just as a quick reference, so I'd mentioned this is a TruLaser 5030 fiber with 24,000 watts. That is a 5x10 format machine. We do also offer the same platform with the same power levels in different machine sizes. So we can go with a 6x12. We can also go with a 6x20, all with the same 24 kilowatt laser source. But now, just to start with, what we want to look at is the optical chain that we're using on the machine. So anywhere from the generation of laser light all the way down to the focusing of the laser light and everything that happens in between. Now that's really kind of the unique thing about being TRUMPF and being vertically integrated. You know, kind of the obvious thing is machine tool builders can start off with building a machine tool, and that's great. And that's usually where it ends amongst the industry, but TRUMPF is quite unique in having that be just our starting point. So yeah, we make a really fantastic machine, but we also make a fantastic laser source and delivery and focusing components to really complement that machine. So the first and most obvious, I think, would be the actual laser source itself. So what we're gonna be using, as I had mentioned early on during the introduction, is a TruDisc 24001. So that's a disc architecture, 1 micron laser beam, like a regular fiber laser. But where this sort of a laser is gonna differ from a traditional fiber source architecturally wise, is its architecture itself is much more robust. So it's able to handle industrial environments much better, but it's also able to better guarantee consistent power long-term. Now, I think what's kind of an interesting and kind of cool little factoid, if we look over at the left, we see the different sort of laser sources that TRUMPF produce. So like we're gonna see today, we have the TruDisc laser, but we also have green versions of the disc laser. So different wavelength of light, primarily for welding copper. But then we also have traditional fiber lasers, just like you would have with other builders out there in the field. And then direct diode lasers, variations of pulse, whether those are rod lasers, whether they're fiber lasers, whether they're disc lasers, all the way up to where we're actually doing excimer lasers for semiconductor manufacturing. So if it has a purpose in the industrial realm for a laser, it's something that TRUMPF is going to produce. So when we're building a really high power laser like this, we're saying, well, you know what we're going to do, rather than just taking what we have and then just slapping a bunch more of those things together, let's scale them properly. So when it comes to the laser source itself, as I had mentioned, one of the nice things about it is not just purely the stability, or the robustness of the platform, but it's also the stability. So when we're looking at a TRUMPF laser compared to really any of the other lasers out there, what you have is a totally consistent power source. So you buy a 24,000 watt laser today, guaranteed 5 years from now, plus or minus 1%, that is still a 24,000 watt laser source. And that can also not vary day to day. So rather than having a plus or minus 1% power consistency or 2% power consistency, which would be relevant to a single shift or 8 hours, that 1% power consistency that TRUMPF offer is actually for the entire life of the laser. And that's because we don't suffer the traditional sort of photochromic effects inside of the laser that cause power losses, but then also just overall loss of efficiency within the entire optical chain. We're actively measuring the laser power. And here is an example of how that actually works. So this little animation shows the interior of the disc laser. So like a fiber laser, you pump the crystal, but then what we're actually doing is we're putting the laser beam into what we call a beam management system. So this is a little free space device that allows us to do a couple things. So one, you see on the bottom, you have two what we call input couplings here. So these couplings allow the disc laser to support for example, multiple processes. One beam could be going to a cutting system, the other could be going to a welding system. But what the laser is doing back here in the rear is it's actually going into a power absorber. And this is really the party trick of the TruDisc laser. By the power going into the absorber, we're able to measure in real time what the required power is from the actual power, and in real time, the laser make adjustments. And that's why you would never see a consistency, a lack of consistency that is less than plus or minus 1% over the laser's entire life. This can be maybe a little bit of a smaller topic when it comes to low power lasers, but when you're talking tens of thousands of watts worth of laser power, a normal, you know, 2-3% power loss per year, like you see with the traditional fiber laser, becomes absolutely critical. So this is a really important component to the overall laser source that we have here. So the next thing we want to look at is the cutting unit itself. So remember, we're talking about the optical chain, and the optical chain includes not only the laser source and the cutting unit, but also the delivery cable that couples those two things together. So when we look at the way that we're actually putting the laser beam from the laser source into the cutting unit through the beam delivery cable, we actually use a really interesting and unique series of components. So these would be what we call LLK connectors. So this is what's actually connecting your beam delivery cable to the laser source or to the optic. And what you would have with a non-TRUMPF system is, quite frankly, a system that's directly spliced, and then there's going to be a design failure within that component. So during the splicing, you get a little bit of a lack of alignment, then you also get some contamination within either the LLK or the optic, and then the LLK, I should clarify, that's your beam delivery cable. And then next thing you know, you're having to replace that component. That's why that's a normal compare a replaceable component in non-TRUMPF systems. So what we use instead is an LLK connector. And we have an LLK connector that's selected based on the different laser power. So rather than saying, hey, I've got this optic and this beam delivery cable that I'm using on my 6-kilowatt laser, I want to go create 30,000 watts of laser power now. Oh, I'm just going to use the exact same components. Well, that's just asking for trouble. So what we do is, based on the amount of power, we choose one of these different components. And within the different components, we have different unique sort of advantages. So on the lower laser powers, we'll use this D connector. On the very high power laser, like we'll see today, we use this X connector. And with this connector type, you're not only guaranteeing that you can't introduce contamination into the interior of the component, but that you also guarantee the alignment. And then even if there is any possibility of contamination, so as I had mentioned with non-TRUMPF systems, you're contaminating laser when you're actually doing the installation. Even if that were to happen, you have a piece of protective glass under that connection point with a scattered light sensor. So not only do we have the ability to replace that glass, we can automatically tell service or operation or whoever might be in charge that that glass needs to be replaced. So it's a really, really cool thing that we have, and it's really a necessary component. So rather than just being interesting, it's something that's going to be required to make sure that this laser continues to produce at the same sort of speed and quality that you expect from day one. Now, this is kind of an interesting graph that we have here too. So what we're looking at is all of the different changes from a 12 kilowatt version of the cutting unit to a 24 kilowatt version of our cutting unit. So again, if you look into the rest of the industry, you have a cutting unit used for 4-6 kilowatt lasers being used for 10, 15, 20, 30 kilowatt lasers, right? Same exact cutting unit. And that's why these are components that are, again, required to be thrown out. So rather than having a cutting unit and lens and all the different bits that are inside it be something that are never going to be replaced, on the other systems, you're actually going to be replacing those as a regular procedure. So we want to avoid that. In order to do that, we need to have a lot of intelligence inside the cutting unit. So we are monitoring for temperature at various different points inside the cutting unit and adding multiple protective glasses inside the thing to make sure that there can't be any contamination inside the cutting unit. But if somehow contamination is introduced, that it can be identified by either temperature sensors or scattered light sensors and then can be addressed. So we have really, really good process reliability. So hopefully when Ian starts running the parts for us, you see pretty impressive speeds, but it's really critical that the entire optical chain is up to the task of making sure those sort of speeds that Ian is going to show us today are consistent and something that you're going to see years down the road in your own facility. So with that said, I think we're going to hop over to Ian now. As it is, we're just kind of starting off with the introduction here. We're going to do some cutting. There will be a time, certainly, for questions and answers, though. So you can hold off on questions that you might have. I'll try to answer some in the chat as they come up. But otherwise, once Ian's done, we'll have about 10 minutes set aside specifically for that. Okay, Ian?
All right. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, sir.
Awesome. So I set up a couple of materials. We'll start off, we're going to be cutting some half-inch material. We'll jump right into that. Let me just line us up here. So with this, we are going to be cutting at 370 inches a minute.
And this is half-inch?
This is half-inch. We're going to be using our EAU100 nozzle for those who are familiar with it. It is our high speed nozzle.
What's our assist gas that we're using?
So we are going to be using a mixed gas right now. We have 3.4% oxygen in here for this cut. This allows us to cut cleaner and faster.
Yeah, that did certainly happen quite quickly.
So that was faster than I could put my gloves on. I should have kept them on the whole time.
Yeah, no kidding. 370 inches a minute. So we can cut this with nitrogen as well if you want just a pure nitrogen edge. It would just be a little bit slower, maybe 15% less or so. So we get a nice clean cut.
Okay. And then the other material I have prepared for this is 2-inch. This will be cutting with oxygen.
Okay, very good. Yeah. So just straight oxygen now. No nitrogen in there, right?
Nope. Just pure oxygen.
Perfect.
Okay. So we are going to do a nozzle change. So with this being 5-series machine, nozzle changer is standard.
Not only a nozzle changer, but the whole smart nozzle automation. So if Ian were to program poorly, which of course he would never do, and he had a little collision on the cutting unit, the awesome thing about the cutting unit, it's got full 360-degree collision protection. It's incredibly good. The only potential thing is maybe we nick the end of the nozzle a little bit. So we have a 3D camera that can actually check and make sure that Ian didn't damage the nozzle too much with one of his not uncommon mistakes.
All right. That is, so, of course, actually referring to himself. It's called transference.
That's true. If I were trying to cut with 24 kilowatts, that may be possible. So we've got a 2-inch material here, and you'll see little pauses at the end of some of the cuts. And what that is a cooling process. So we'll get to the end of the lead in point usually, and what the laser is doing is blowing a little bit of oxygen on the surface, just kind of keep it cool a little bit. So there's your other cooling process. What is our feed rate again for 2-inch, Ian?
This is 30 inches a minute.
30 inches a minute, okay. And you might notice too a little bit of oil shooting off from the left side. So standard on the machine is what we call an oil spray device. So we put a little bit of oil on the surface to make sure that material that is being bulged up during the pierce just doesn't stick to the surface of the material. Keeps it nice and clean.
And that's standard on all machines, TRUMPF.
Standard indeed. Now look at that, the part even drops afterwards. 2 inches and it dropped. That's pretty impressive.
I gotta be careful here. I don't have the right gloves for this.
Can we cook some bacon and eggs on there so people see that you're being genuine?
I don't know. Can you see the distortion from the heat coming off of there? Because I can.
Yeah, you look like you're a mirage. Can you put a 90 degree on that? Maybe one of the little,
let's see,
rounding examples. I think one of the cool things about this, what Ian's going to show us here, is that the edge perpendicularity is pretty much perfect. We measured less than half a degree of taper on the part. So that is really quite impressive. And it goes to the fact that we have such a broad bandwidth. He's even measuring on the bottom side. So he's a real renegade there. You can see there's hardly any light gap. So your beam is nice and straight, utilizing the bright line fiber functionality that we have on this machine. We get a huge kerf without sacrificing process stability and making the waist of the beam very, very short. So we get nice consistency. So that's 2-inch material, 1-inch holes. So the holes that are being put in the part are half material thickness. We've got other samples, 1.5-inch material. What are the holes in that thingy, and 1/4-inch?
So I put 1/4-inch holes in the 1.5 material.
Yeah, which is pretty wild. So you can do a pretty impressive contouring. So really what it comes down to is something like 2-inch. We say, okay, you know, on a speed perspective, is it really comparable to a plasma table? And, you know, yeah, plasma's kind of made for this sort of thing, but where plasma is really going to be lacking is when you're looking at the perpendicularity of the edge, but then also those sort of contours. To be able to do a 1/4-inch hole and 1.5-inch carbon steel, that's pretty impressive. It's really only doable with, you know, a laser like this or with a water jet.
Waiting for a little more 2-inch material to come in so that I can put some 1/4-inch holes in that, because I feel like I could probably do it.
Yeah, I think so. I think it could be done. That's actually that's 50 mm material. The capacity of the machine is 60. That'd be what, that's 2 3/8, I think, inches. So we're not even topping the thing out right now. It's pretty impressive what it can do. Can you refresh me on what the feed rate was with 2-inch?
For 2-inch, it was 30 inches a minute.
Okay. So, to the question that we have in the chat room here. So it was, I already forgot, 30 inches a minute, you said?
30 inches.
It's amazing.
He's got some problems, yeah. Guys. It's all good.
As soon as I hit 40, it was downhill from there, I tell you. So, 30 inches a minute, that's cruising right along. We had a question about the kerf diameter. Can you see what the kerf is for the 2-inch? I don't know if you have the actual kerf.
I don't know the actual kerf. Right now, it's – hold on 1 second. I'll just look up what we have as our theoretical. Okay. But I haven't.
Yeah, we haven't actually measured. It's probably around 40 thousandths or so, I would say, looking at it. But you can see what it is on the control, or at least, like Ian says, what the theoretical is. And this is a value
it's about 50,000.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Well, that seems like it's probably pretty close. So we're using that kerf value to determine what the offset is. Of course, you know, when we're cutting the part, we have to make that compensation. So that's a value that's stored to the control. So now Craig is asking whether or not cool line still has a use on this machine, since you're not using it for 2-inch.
Yes, there's definitely going to be tech tables available with CoolLine on it. There are certain ones that won't have it. This tech table is a standard oxygen table, so it doesn't have a CoolLine available. I don't know if they're working on one for it in the future, but we do have CoolLine available for certain thicknesses.
Yeah, I think it's a relevant question, because when you're cutting with oxygen, because CoolLine is an oxygen process. So when you're cutting with oxygen at such a high rate of speed, of course, it's going to put less heat into the material. So it's probably not as necessary as it would be at 10, 12 kilowatts. But yeah, I could certainly see there being use for it. Particularly what we found with the water cooling is it can be a little bit more forgiving when the material qualities vary a bit. So now maybe from that perspective, it could be helpful for us. So I've got 2 questions from Alejandro. One is what mix we're using. So as far as the mix earlier, we have nitrogen primarily, and then we have a little bit of oxygen mixed in. And your actual mixture was what, 3.5% oxygen?
Correct. Yeah. And that can vary anywhere from 2% up to 5, maybe sometimes 6%, depending on the thickness and the grade of steel. But generally, we find that we're right around the 3.5% that works for most materials.
Yeah, sir, and that seems to be one of those things where if I'm setting up a gas mixer, 3.5% is probably a good general value, right?
Yeah.
So we found on some materials with different carbon or silica contents that sometimes actually going with very low oxygen contents can actually be helpful. But yeah, for your general diet of A36, like we're running here, the 3.5% seems to be pretty darn good.
Yeah, once you start to go over that, it kind of causes issues because now you're introducing too much oxygen, but you're not burning it like you would normally burn oxygen. So it causes problems.
Absolutely. So Alejandro also asked what nozzle and gas pressure we're using for the mix process.
So for that particular one, we are using our EAU100 nozzle. Let me see if I have one that we could look at.
So that would be a 10 millimeter nozzle, but it's a 10 millimeter nozzle with a Venturi, so the pressures are very low. So if you had a normal 10 millimeter nozzle, you would have basically, you'd have to start your own nitrogen generation
yeah.
business to supplement your the rest of your sheet metal cutting. But with the that little outer ring, basically what it's doing is it's creating an outer coating to stabilize the cut. So this is compromise, so our high speed eco. So if you don't want something that's actually contacting the surface, this just creates a sheath of the assist gas around the actual active gas in the middle. So it's a really good compromise because it's still very low pressure. So it means that the system that we need for gas mixing, it's going to be a little bit less. It means the amount of assist gas that we're consuming also going to be quite a bit less. So it's a really handy nozzle to use, and that's what we use in a lot of cases unless we get down into the thinner materials where we maybe want to be super aggressive with our pierces, those sort of things.
Yeah, for that half inch that I was cutting, it was only 5 bar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, pretty impressive. So let me see here. So another question that we have is an interesting one, Ian. So can you cut 3/4 with N2 and how fast?
Yes. So we've cut 3/4 with nitrogen. I'm trying to remember exactly what the speed was. I want to say it was 150 inches a minute, I think. The mixed gas was 195. So I believe the nitrogen was around 150 to 175. Let's see if I have it on here.
Yeah, that was one of the thicknesses where it seemed like we picked up a lot of speed with the mixed gas.
Yeah, because with the mixed gas, it's 195 inches a minute. With nitrogen, it's 170.
Okay, so 170 with nitrogen, 195 yeah. with mixed gas. Okay, which I think that kind of leads into another question, which is what is the capacity for mixed gas cutting with this amount of laser power?
So I'm going up to 1 inch right now in mild steel. And we're getting up to 120 inches a minute, depending on the quality, but generally I'm around 115, 110.
Yeah, thanks for that. Really what we see is when we switch over, since with Brightline fiber, we can create a very large laser beam, which means that we do a much more efficient job of exposing the vaporized material through the kerf. And so we can actually utilize all the laser power with a flame cut. So when we're cutting with oxygen, we're actually cutting at 24 kilowatts. We're not, you know, cutting laser power in half. And so actually for our 1 inch mixed gas is what, 115 inches a minute. And it's about the same for oxygen there. So really it becomes a question of practicality. Could Ian stretch its capability out a little bit more and go to 1.25 with mixed gas? Yeah, he probably could. Despite being very short, he's actually quite good around a laser. But the reality is, I don't think that it would have any benefit to it. I think the part costs would start to become a little bit high. So, yeah, it might actually have more capacity than what we're really applying it for, but we believe that that's a practical limit for it. But who knows what's going to happen in the future. So we have a question about the max acceleration with the 24 kilowatt. So, and this is kind of an interesting question. So, depends on the the cut that we're using, or the cutting process. So we're going to have, when we're doing oxygen, a lower acceleration into the cut than we would with thin materials using a special high-speed table that we call IA5. And, you know, with those, we can achieve very high acceleration values. But really where this thing distances itself and why it's the fastest machine in the market is the rate of change of acceleration. So it's able to go, so when you're going from zero to your max acceleration, so let's say your max acceleration is, you know, 4G. Well, you don't go from zero to 4G immediately. The amount of time it takes to go from zero to full acceleration and then from full acceleration to zero is a subset of velocity called jerk factor. And you have to have a really, really well-built machine tool to be able to handle very high jerk factors because it puts a lot of stress on the machine. And the 5030 fiber, and actually all the 5 series fiber machines, have exceptionally high rate of change of acceleration values or jerk factors. So the acceleration is, you know, what you would expect out of a high-end machine like this, but the jerk values are much higher than you see in competitive machines. And that's really where the performance gains are going to come from. Let me read through the list here. I'm kind of coming in. So up to what thickness can nitrogen cutting be used? And I'm guessing this is going to be, of course, for mild steel, because if it were stainless steel or aluminum, we'd be going up to, you know, the full 60 millimeters. So in oxygen, Ian, what do you say is the
you mean for up to steel for nitrogen cutting?
Yes.
It is 3/4 right now as far as the tech tables go. I have cut 1 inch with it. I don't know if it would be what people would consider desirable. It does have some stuff down at the bottom. But right now, the tech tables go up to 3/4 with nitrogen.
Thank you for that. I think it becomes, you know, another one of those questions of practicality. We've done it on 1 inch. It's slower than the oxygen table is. Again, the oxygen table is 100 inches a minute. So it just doesn't make sense to use a higher pressure process that's going to, of course, cost more.
Yeah.
So we've really, you know, when it comes to fusion cutting, we focused on that material range and using the mixed gas. Everything that we're showing pretty much for these mid-thick materials, let's say, even down a 1/4 inch, we started playing with the mixed gas. Traditionally, we haven't done that. We just like the speed gain that you get. But we've really started using, I'd say, from 1/2 inch to 1 inch, a mixed gas process here, even though it's not necessary. So if you say, well, but I don't have a gas mixer and I don't want one, it's no problem. You just use nitrogen. We just happen to be showing the mixed gas system here because it's a little bit quicker than nitrogen. Let's see here. So minimum amount of oxygen. So what gas pressure are we using on the 1/2 inch material?
It was 5 bar.
It was 5 bar again. Yeah, so that was a high speed EAU process. Do we have IA5 tables for that material?
For 1/2 inch, no.
No. Okay. So what we're talking about with that all is a special parameter set that lets the cutting unit keep the nozzle nice and far from the workpiece, like 1/160,000 of an inch, and that uses a regular nozzle but with higher gas pressure. So that's. So why I'm asking Ian that there's a trade-off in speed, or there's a trade-off for speed at the detriment of gas consumption. So here's a good question, Ian. So when you're cutting that 2-inch part, were your interior contours being cut at the same speed as your exterior contours?
Yes. Yep. They were the same parameters for that.
That's definitely a good question, because that's typically, like, if you're not, certainly you couldn't do a 2-inch piece of material on a CO2 laser, but even doing 1-inch material at 1/2 the material thickness, you would have to use what we would call small contour. And when you're using that, the laser reduces its power, starts pulsing, really slows down, all that sort of thing.
Yeah, I would say if I went with like a 3/4 hole or maybe a 5/8 hole, I'd start to have to reduce it down to use a little less power, just because there'd be so much heat in the center of that cut. But as it is with the 1 inch, I was able to do it at large contour, as we call it.
Awesome. Well, we're at the end of the meeting. So I want to address just one more thing, because I think it's actually the answer to it is fairly cool. So the question being, is there a conveyor and optimal option for this high power machine due to melting? So do you want to explain what we do?
Yeah, so what we've come up with on this now, so there is a conveyor system. And what is really cool about this is the conveyor will actually change speed depending on the direction that we are cutting in. And another thing that's really nice on here is, say somebody was to slow this down to 80%, that's going to slow all the drives down on the machine, including things like the conveyor. So we've built in a safety now that if somebody slows this down on the potentiometer to 80%, it actually reduces the laser power as well, so that we're not burning up components that are shooting down through the slats.
That is a very good question. And we also have the ability to turn a laser beam off if it's off the sheet for a while. So another really kind of cool safety function that just, we kind of take for granted here. But there are a lot of questions that have come in, and I certainly appreciate those. So if you, if I don't get to any of the questions, please do feel free to reach out to us. And I and myself will be happy to address any questions that you have. Also, you're free to reach out to your sales rep if you'd like to see some of your own parts be run on the machine. But until next time, thank you very much for joining us today, and we'll see you down the road. Thanks again.
Thanks, guys.